Hello, this is Dr. Gadekar from Government Polytechnic Pune. Welcome again to the second session on centrifugal pump. Last time we closed our session with this slide in which we saw various features of centrifugal pump. Just to summarize, it is a rotodynamic pump and not a positive displacement pump, and it is especially used for high discharge and low head. But priming is necessary to start this centrifugal pump. Now let's go ahead, and in this particular session we will see the construction and working of centrifugal pump. As shown in this figure, the centrifugal pump consists of strainer, footwall, suction pipe, casing inside which there is an impeller which is fitted on a shaft of a motor, then the delivery valve, delivery pipe and the overhead tank. Here you can see the priming wall also. We will deal with it in the next session. So these are all the components of centrifugal pump. Foot wall with strainer. So the bottommost part of the centrifugal pump is a strainer, and inside it there is a foot wall. So strainer is like a net which arrests the entry of foreign particles, debris, etc. It is fitted to a foot wall. Foot wall is a one-way valve which allows the entry of water in upward direction only and prevents its backward flow back to the sump. So this is the important part of the centrifugal pump. Next comes the suction pipe. So to one end of the suction pipe there is this footwall and strainer, and the other end of suction pipe is connected to the eye of an impeller, the central part of the impeller. Next comes the impeller, most important part, the rotating part of the centrifugal pump mounted on the shaft of the electric motor. It consists of series of backward vanes, and main function of impeller is to convert the kinetic energy of liquid by applying the centrifugal force on it. Depending on the types of liquid handled by the pump, there are three types of impellers: fully closed, semi-closed and open type impeller. Let's see the details of the impeller as shown in this figure. This is a fully closed type of impeller. Why it is called as fully closed? Because these vanes are covered by the back plate and the top plate or the crown plate. So these vanes are embedded in between these two plates. It provides better guidance for the liquid, and therefore it gives high efficiency to the pump. This type of impeller is used when the liquid which is to be pumped is free from impurities or debris. Otherwise, the impurities or debris may clog this impeller. So it is only used when the water quality or the liquid quality is very, very pure. It is made up of generally cast iron, but depending on the nature of liquid to be handled, it can also be prepared from stainless steel or with steel having some kind of coating. Next, semi-open impeller, as is visible in this figure. It has only one plate at the base of it, that is base plate, and the crown plate is upset. So vanes are mounted on only one plate. This type of impeller is used when the liquid to be pumped contains some amount of debris or foreign particles, such as sewage, water or paper pulp. These impellers have less number of vanes. Then the third type, that is open impeller, as you can see in the figure, it has only vanes or blades, no base plate, no crown plate. So obviously this kind of impeller is used only when the water to be pumped consists of large amount of debris, coarse particles, for example, mixture of water and sand or clay, etc. So absence of both the plates reduces the chances of clogging. Casing, another important part of centrifugal pump. It's an airtight chamber having a particular shape. The casing of centrifugal pump is so designed that the kinetic energy of water is converted into pressure energy before it leaves the casing. This considerably increases the efficiency of the pump. The casing also comes in three varieties: volute or spiral casing, vortex or whirlpool casing, volute casing with guide blades, or it is also called as diffuser casing. So casing is an important part. It has a hydraulic function here. It has to convert the kinetic energy of the water coming out of impeller into effective pressure head, so that water can be lifted to the desired height. This figure shows you all the three types of casings. This is a volute casing, this is a vortex casing, and this is a diffuser casing. Let's go into the details of this. This figure shows you the volute or spiral casing. Quite obvious, its shape is spiral or volute in nature, that's why it is called as the volute casing. As you can see, as we go away from this point towards the end of the casing, the area gets gradually increasing. So with the increasing in area, the kinetic energy reduces, and this reduction in kinetic energy gets converted into increase in pressure energy. Therefore, this casing is shaped in this particular manner. So the important function of casing is to convert gradually the kinetic energy of the water into effective pressure head. However, some losses takes place here, and considering these losses and the formation of eddies in this particular part, the efficiency may get affected due to this formation of eddies. Therefore, we have another type in which there is a circular chamber inserted just after the impeller and before the water enters into the vortex chamber, volute casing. This is called as vortex chamber. So it's just a circular ring. See, now the water is entering first into the vortex chamber and then into the volute casing. So in vortex chamber itself, some conversion of energy from kinetic to pressure takes place, and then the subsequent conversion of kinetic energy into pressure energy takes place in vortex chamber. The loss of energy due to formation of eddies is reduced with this particular design of the casing. That's why this particular casing helps to increase efficiency of the pump. Then we have the third type of casing, that is casing with guide blades. You can see here, just after the impeller, there is a set of vanes which are fitted on the ring. These are called as guide vanes. And the area between these two vanes of the guide vanes gradually increases, and this helps to increase the pressure from kinetic energy. So kinetic energy gets converted into the effective pressure energy, and water guides the or the guide vanes guides the water effectively. That's why this type of casing gives you high efficiency. But mind well, here the shape of the casing is not spiral, and generally in most of the cases it is concentric with the impeller. So this is another change here. Then delivery pipe. So delivery pipe is connected at one end to the casing, and the other end of delivery pipe is connected to the delivery tank. We can control the discharge of water through this pump with the help of a delivery valve. So delivery valve helps us to control the discharge given by the centrifugal pump. Now let us concentrate on the principle of operation, as is shown here. Again, this is the central part, eye of an impeller. Then this is casing, impeller. This is casing, and it is connected to the delivery pipe. So pump is first filled with water, which is called as priming. Then impeller is rotated. Due to centrifugal action, the water is thrown away from the center. Therefore, partial vacuum gets created at the eye of a centrifugal pump. So more water is drawn here through the suction pipe. This water is also pumped out into the casing and then into the delivery pipe. So this is how water is being sucked at the eye of a impeller and continuously thrown away into the casing and to the discharge pipe. So this is how continuously water is lifted to the delivery tank. This particular slide adds some more information. You can see here, this is the impeller which is rotating. This is the eye part of the impeller. So suction pipe is connected here and water is sucked at the central part, eye of the centrifugal pump. When this impeller is rotated, the water over here is thrown away from the center due to centrifugal action. That's why again partial pressure is created, water is sucked and again thrown away. So this continues and this is how we get the discharge. We have a small animation here which shows the working of centrifugal pump. Let us see a small animation on working of centrifugal pump. This is taken from YouTube. So this is the animation of suction pipe, impeller and casing and delivery pipe. Now water is being sucked through the suction pipe at the center of the impeller, which is also called as eye of an impeller. Now the impeller is rotating, that's why it throws away the water particles in the outward direction, which is collected into the casing and then sent to the delivery pipe. If you observe the path of the water particle, then you can see that water which is entering at the center part of the impeller, that is eye of an impeller, follows a spiral path, and that's why this particular casing is called as spiral casing. So this is how water is sucked and discharged in the delivery pipe. I hope this animation has cleared your idea to a great extent. So to sum up, I once again tell you the construction part and working part. We have seen that it consists of various parts like footwall and strainer, suction pipe, then the impeller, which is inside a casing, which is connected to the delivery pipe and then to the delivery tank. We have a delivery wall there. Generally, before we start the centrifugal pump, the delivery wall is kept closed. We start the motor, so impeller starts rotating. It throws away the water, and when it catches the normal speed, then the delivery wall is open and then it can lift the water to the desired height. So mind well, initially before we start the centrifugal pump, the delivery wall is closed and then it is opened when the impeller moves with a normal speed. So we'll stop here in this session. In the next session, we will discuss priming, then various terminologies associated with this pump, then the multi-stage pump and cavitation. So with this, we stop here only. Thank you.